Hello there, everybody. Thank you for sticking with us late into the afternoon here at the Milken Global Conference. If I were to ask most of you yesterday, or maybe not yesterday, perhaps a month ago before you saw the conference program, who the CEO of Citadel Securities was, most of you, I'll wager, would have said, oh, that's Ken Griffin. The truth of the matter is, it's this guy. Peng Zhao is someone whom most of you don't yet know much about. And this is an opportunity for you to understand who he is, how he thinks, and where he's taking his business, together with Ken, of course. Peng, it's great to see you.
Thank you, Eric.
So why don't we begin there? I think it's a sensible place to start, what I would call the quote-unquote Peng Zhao story, how a self-described math nerd who grew up in Beijing ended up not just working at Citadel, but thriving in Ken Griffin's world and helping him to build what most participants in the markets you serve would call the world's most fearsome market-making machine.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me, Eric, and many thanks to the Milken Institute and Michael Milken for hosting us here. And you're right, I don't do this very often. So for those of you who have never seen me speak.
Like everybody.
I do see a few friends in the audience. I do still have friends. So maybe a quick story about myself. So I grew up in Beijing, China. Yes, you're right. I was a math nerd, still am. In fact, I've been a math nerd for as long as I can remember. I was raised by a pair of parents that worked extremely hard, took a lot of risks, and made a lot of sacrifices. In fact, my father worked in Hong Kong throughout the 90s. And I'm very much a child of the 90s as well, the 90s China.
That's your adolescence and young adulthood was
exactly,
the 90s.
My formative years. And there were two things that I remember my father really brought back from Hong Kong. One was just amazing ramen, instant noodles. I was always look forward to the instant noodles he brought back from Hong Kong. And then the other was stories about the stock market. And in fact, every winter I had the opportunity to visit him and stay with him during the winter break in Hong Kong. I was both fascinated by all the numbers and charts and graphs on the TV screen all the time, but also by how fundamental the financial market was and still is, not just to the economic life, but also the everyday life.
What business was your father in?
He was a state representative for a large state-owned enterprise in Hong Kong. Mm. They were in the cargo shipping business. Mm-hmm. They own ports and large cargo ships. But that was inescapable, right? When you're in Hong Kong, that's what you see all the time. And that was in contrast with the still being built and still being developed Chinese financial market in the 90s. And I think that was a huge part of what got me into finance. And that combined with me being a math nerd, I guess not surprisingly, got me to apply my analytical skills and my interest in data engineering towards solving the market, even before I knew what that meant.
Yeah. You're thinking about the solving market problems at what age?
when I was probably 10, 11, 12 years old, yeah. I went to school relatively early. I went to college when I was 14 years old. So I guess to get the timeline straight, that was the important data point, yeah.
That's important. Now, most people who go to college at the age of 14, how should I put it? Well, let's just say they're usually pretty intelligent, above average at the very least. At what point did they put you on an accelerated path?
Math is one of those things where
you're either good at it or you're not.
Yeah, in a sense, right? So, I mean, I knew, I wanted to pursue mathematics because curiosity. I was fascinated by the subject. I had affinity to numbers, to data. So I studied applied mathematics in college. And then
this was where?
This was in Peking University in Beijing. And after that, I then came to United States for my PhD in statistics, machine learning, and data science at UC Berkeley.
Mm-hmm.
And then shortly after that, well, actually right after that, I started working at Citadel. So other than a few part-time jobs I've had, I've only worked at one place. I joined Citadel Ken right after grad school. And I've been at the firm for 17 years. Never know what a different corporate culture would be like.
So Ken quite famously was trading out of his dorm room at Harvard. Did you have a similar story where you were finding ways to, as it were, beat the market while you were doing your PhD?
No, I couldn't afford putting satellite dishes on my on my dorm roof. So he was way ahead of me on that. I think my best trade was to buy 100 shares of Apple stock with the money I made from my internship. That was probably the highest return trade I've ever done.
17 years ago, Citadel was a very different business from
Absolutely.
Where it is today. Why Citadel then? I presume you know, what else did you look at?
Yes, I had a number of opportunities when I was graduating. But as soon as I met the folks at Citadel during my interview, it was just very obvious. I just had to go there. The talent, the drive, the ambition, which is too compelling, right? And I tell people, you know, in a format not too different from this when I talk to prospective candidates, that it's like seeing a rocket ship traveling near light speed, but it was still just taking off, right? And I met Ken when he was 38. He was already a rock star. He was a maverick on Wall Street. But the amount of growth that the firm has had and the amount of growth that he has had as an individual and a leader, not just for the firm, but also for the industry and the country, has been unbelievable the last 17 years.
What did they hire you to do?
I started off as a quantitative researcher. So I managed numbers, then I managed strategies, and I managed businesses. And 7 years ago, I started running the firm. So,
you know, I think of you, in part because of the way that you've just described yourself, as a trader scientist, trader engineer, trader mathematician.
That'd be accurate, yeah.
Okay, you think of yourself in similar
yes.
terms.
Yes.
And I think of Ken as, clearly he's an investor, but he's also embraced to a large degree macro thinking, so let's talk of Ken as an investor economist, if you were. I mean, he's not your traditional economist, mm-hmm. but maybe sometimes the non-traditional economists are better than the traditional economists. Why is that a good combination? You know, and why are you a good fit for him? A good compliment maybe to him? Because let's be honest, Citadel's reputation precedes it in many ways. Of course, it has an amazing track record as a fund, and clearly, as we'll talk about in a few minutes, it's developed, as I described before, a fearsome business in market making, but it also has a reputation for being ruthless, and Ken has a reputation, deserved or undeserved, for having very little patience for failure. Talk about, you know, why that, the culture that he has built and the person whom he is resonates with you personally.
No, absolutely. I mean, look, we're very fact-driven, right? And we're always willing to debate, but always try to agree on the basis of fact, of doing what's right, not doing what is necessarily the most popular thing in the room, right?
You're not a relativist.
And I think my interaction with Ken in many different ways can be summarized by something that he said before, right? We think about every conversation as either a teaching opportunity or a learning opportunity, right? And then throughout the years, I learned from many learning opportunities for me, right? Learning about how to model and solve the market, learning how to run a business, learning about how to be a leader. And in some ways, I think I've been able to teach him a few things about data science, machine learning, and AI as well.
I'm sure, and we'll talk about that too. Again, assuming that many people here in the room, watching now after the fact, don't know that much about Citadel Securities, let's put some size and scope around your business. You know, what it is, how large it is, we can define that in a number of different ways, and more importantly, again, going back to the concept that I introduced earlier, what problems you're trying to solve.
Sure, sure, let's start with that, right? So, at its core, the financial market, or we sometimes call the capital market, serves the function of facilitating transactions between people who want to raise capital and people who have capital to invest mm-hmm. for profit. Now, when those people come to the market, the supply and demand of capital is rarely perfectly matched up. In fact, it's never perfectly matched up. Whether we're talking
That's why they're intermediaries.
Right. Whether we're talking about the time scale of days, hours, or seconds. Right. That's when firms like ourselves, acting as market makers, stepping in and trying to plug that gap. And we try to do this by essentially taking into account anything that's happening anywhere in the world that might meaningfully factor into the price formation of something we trade, right? So order magnitude, we have roughly 100 petabytes of data. So if you don't know what petabyte is, that's about 1,000 terabytes. And the amount of data that we use roughly doubles every 3 years, right? And then we process that and we form our pricing and strategies on the basis of that, and that demands a lot of computation as well. And we go up to use about 1 million cores, right? CPU cores concurrently at a given time.
So what's that comparable to? Let's talk about the petabytes from 100 petabytes.
It's 100 petabytes of data. That
right, 100 petabytes of data. How many cores?
About 1 million concurrently.
Okay, so what can we equate that to? Give us something, another real world example, maybe that people might be more familiar with.
Yeah. So all the text that's ever been printed in human history can be stored in order magnitude a few petabytes. So we can store that many times over. We can store all the books that's ever been printed many times over. And 1 million cores would be a very large percentage of some of the largest computing clouds that exist in the world.
Like AWS, for example.
Like AWS or Google Cloud, who is our partner?
Azure or?
Or Azure, yes.
Is there any, to your knowledge, is there anyone, I mean, these are relevant statistics. Is there anyone else in finance who's processing as much data as you are?
Yeah, we're probably so our partner is Google, and we're probably the most relevant partner of Google's on the cloud computing side.
Their largest customer, in other words.
Largest or not is a statistic that they won't share with us. Uh-huh. We're certainly
up there.
Up there, yeah. And we work very closely with them.
Yeah. And exclusively with Google, no redundancy, no?
No, we certainly use other cloud providers as well. If Google goes down tomorrow, we will be able to operate, no problem.
So why is it so critical to Citadel Securities' success to be able to store and process such a vast quantity of data?
Yeah.
And is that a differentiator? There are clearly other market makers, and I'm assuming they store and process some data too.
Yeah, yeah. No, so if you go back to the 90s and you looked at how this was done back then, you would see a lot of traders, a lot of trading followers, right? And that's why in popular imagination,
it's like the Spear Leads and Kellogg's.
Exactly. It's always, I mean, even today, you open up CNBC, there's always that like nervous looking person, trader looking up at the stock screen. So that's built into our understanding and image of the market.
It's a conceit, really,
yes.
Right?
Absolutely. Now, the task of processing all that information and make quick decision on that is much better and more efficiently done through automation, analytics, and artificial intelligence, and being able to process all the information that's relevant in at speed, with accuracy, with sophistication, is absolutely first order importance if you want to be a cutting edge market maker in the markets today. It's a staple of developed markets today.
And was that a realization that either you, or it probably wasn't you at the time, I'm assuming Ken and others had, about the manner in which to be successful as a market maker from the very beginning?
Absolutely. So I think being—
dating back to when, roughly?
So we started Citadel Securities in 2002, 20 years ago.
Yep.
Citadel Securities was started on the basis of US equity options market making.
Mm-hmm.
And since day one, the vision was to apply modern technology and analytics and automate much of the repetitive manual labor that's involved in making markets for US options market, but all the other products over time. Yeah.
So as you've explained, and most people now understand, the automation and technology have transformed financial markets, and we've gone from an era of person-to-person to person-to-machine. Now we're getting into machine-to-machine and this sort of quaint idea of lots of people populating a trading floor, shouting at one another and slamming phones down is largely a thing of the past. But humans are still part of the equation.
Yeah.
For how much longer?
So that's oftentimes a misconception. So we actually have roughly the same number of traders as we have researchers.
What are they doing?
So I paused that a moment, right?
Yeah.
The difference is just because we use a lot of machines, we use a lot of models, doesn't mean that all the decision making are entirely automated. So the traders we have today versus the traders in the 90s standing on the floor, the comparison is more fighter jet pilots versus runners. And in fact, we call the trading station our traders have cockpits, right? Literally. So we put so much analytics and technology at the fingertips of our traders. Every decision they make is powered orders of magnitude more and scaled out into every product, every bit of the products they want to trade all over the world. In some ways, that's why I am personally very optimistic with the current AI revolution that we're facing, because I believe being liberated from the repetitive mental laboring aspect of what we have to do as humans, that allows humans to focus on the highest value add portion of
Clearly,
the task.
That is the most optimistic view. There are other views.
Yeah.
And we can talk about them, but for the moment, what is it that the traders still do?
Yeah, so when something happens that is very much in the middle of the distribution of what's happening all the time, we've seen this a million times in the past, and 51 out of 100 times it goes one way, 49 out of 100 times it goes the other way.
Right in the middle of the
right, so the average outcome is this and that, so just go ahead and make the right decision in those circumstances, right?
The machine takes
most of the time, right? Okay. And there's very little value as humans we add into that process, right? But when a relatively unique situation arises, and I'm not just talking about Silicon Valley Bank just failed. I'm talking about unique situations, large and small, that occurs all the time, every day. Probably happened 200 times just today.
Mm-hmm.
That's when we need to apply our logic, extrapolate from history and data that we've seen, and apply reason, apply logic, to then decide, okay, here's how it's different this time, right? The algorithm's never seen COVID.
The which?
The algorithms have never seen COVID when that happened, right?
But they'd seen SARS.
They have seen, but very, like, to what extent do we borrow the lessons, exactly, to what extent do we borrow the lessons we've learned from SARS, and to what extent would this be different? right? If you just simply have said, hey, SARS happened, there was some volatility, no market closed, and everything would be fine, you would have been made the, you would have made a mistake.
A very serious mistake.
Yes.
So you mentioned your optimistic view of AI and how it can relieve us humans of needlessly repetitive tasks. Does that apply to trading as well? And I'm interested in understanding more, and I think others probably are as well, about the manner in which you've explored the current boundaries of data science through machine learning and through artificial intelligence, and now, I mean, we're just waking up to the possibilities thanks to our familiarity with ChatGPT, but large language models are probably something you've been messing around with for a little while, I'm guessing.
Well, so first of all, I've spent a lot of time just with my daughter playing around with ChatGPT, trying to have ChatGPT write poems about this girl who loves swimming and ice cream. And if you haven't done so, it's a great thing to do with your kids, right? And for
all, you think it's instructive?
It's absolutely instructive, and it's important to get a real personal sense of how far the technology has gone and all the possibilities that will come after that. Look, we've been practicing AI for a long time, right? So if I take a step back and talk about what is ChatGPT, what does it mean for us, and why are we all of a sudden talking about AI right at this moment, let's take a step back from a 10,000 feet. You can really think about the problem in terms of cognitive models, right? There are different types of cognitive models, such as numerical reasoning, verbal reasoning, symbolic reasoning, and spatial reasoning, and et cetera. There are other proposed models as well. What we have been mostly doing is what I would consider numerical reasoning, right? Because we take a lot of data, 100 petabyte of it, we push it through our algorithms, and this 100 petabytes of data are largely numerical data, price, volume, of all the things that trades around the world. And then we push it through our models and algorithms, and what comes out of the other side are prices of things that we want to trade and trading decisions. And these are all things that are numerical in nature. Okay. The recent breakthrough in ChatGPT, and more broadly speaking, all the large language models, LLMs, that we've been spending a lot of time talking about, including at this conference, are in the area of verbal reasoning. Mm-hmm. Right. Now we are able to push language data through these models, and very impressively also get language outputs coming out the other end. And we've been very excited about this for a few different reasons. And number one, obviously, to the extent we're taking in some language inputs already, we can do so more efficiently at a larger quantity that will further help us in coming up with better prices. But perhaps more importantly, this provides a chance to more fundamentally change how we organize information, how we query knowledge, and how we communicate with each other. Now, one of the most important thing, right, the most common spoken language in my firm is actually programming language. And programming language is a language that we use as humans to speak to machines. So that alone would be a game changer. In that area alone would be a game changer. How do we develop? How do we build our software? How do we think about architecture? And what kind of engineering talent will we look to attract going forward?
How far along are you in that respect already?
I think last time when Ken was asked about this question, we were actively negotiating contracts. We have negotiated those contracts, and we're actively exploring and brainstorming about various different use cases at the company. And many individuals, including myself, have been playing around with the technology in our personal time.
So you might use those technologies to help manage your risks better?
Absolutely.
Other people might use them, I won't say in more nefarious ways, but, you know, trying to game, as it were, financial markets. Do you see evidence that these large language models are already being put to use in investing, or let's not, I don't think of that as investing, in trading strategies?
Not yet. Other than taking in information and have that incorporated into how you price things, which we have been doing, and some of our top peers have been doing to our knowledge as well. But using these large language models, especially the generative aspect of it, to influence the market, while that hasn't happened yet, I think that's a very real possibility, right?
With what consequences?
So think about just over the last few years, right? We had meme stocks, we had Twitter-led bank runs, we had, you know, election influence, right? We had
disinformation,
and
sure.
We also had like just general misinformation, disinformation, online hate. And imagine when someone start driving such phenomena with AI, right? Imagine what are versions of these events that are powered by AI. And that's a real risk. And that is a much more immediate risk comparing to, you know, artificial general intelligence, the rise of the robots that will come and use killer drones and kill us all. And that risk is here right now. The technology already exists.
To do things such as
influence retail investors to buy a stock to their own benefit, create tweets that become impossible to tell or very hard to tell whether it's real or not.
Deep fakes
that may cause another bank run, right? And so enough, we will would become harder and harder for us to tell whether something is real or not. And before we know it, large financial consequence, it will move market faster, in faster and quicker ways.
With more volatility, I presume.
With more volatility. And sometimes the consequence of those events alone will become permanent, even if the original catalyst for it
was
is later determined to be fake, like bank runs, potential bank runs.
So you see these as real risks?
Absolutely.
And you're already thinking about how to manage them or to defend against them or you tell me.
So in many ways, we will manage our own trading and risks internally. But a lot of this risk, its first order impact is on the market at large or on the society at large. I think there have been many conversations here at the conference and outside of this conference about what kind of regulation we need, what kind of investment we need to do as a government to stop these things from happening before it happens, right? And we've learned this in our own line of work. As the market transformed from a human-to-human market, as you have talked about, to a machine-to-human market, to a machine-to-machine market, we have to evolve, right? So organizations like FINRA, which is a self-regulatory organization, was partially very effective at doing this, right? It was able to put together industry experts who are on the cutting edge of how to think about market-related phenomena. Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, this makes sense, but there is an important distinction to be drawn between self-regulatory organizations and regulatory organizations. Mm-hmm. I guess the question you seem to think, I'm inferring from what you say, that's the direction in which this needs to go, because why? Because government can't respond fast
enough? Right, so I worry, and I think I'm not unique in this, that we don't yet have the expertise and the ability to make decisions quickly enough in the government to react in time for the quickly incoming risk that we just talked about. So being able to pull industry experts together and give them government-granted authorities to start making changes seems to be a first-order, no-brainer decision that we should all agree on and start acting.
It seems to me, based on what you say and the few things that we already know, there should be some urgency to this, no?
Absolutely.
Is there urgency?
In the industry and in the AI research community, there absolutely is. I think if we can just get together and agree, then we can start making real changes.
I should have brought this up a little earlier. Actually, before I get to what probably is going to amount to being my last question, how, given what you just said about the risks that you see, and that's just a small sliver of risks that AI may introduce into financial markets, can you be as optimistic about it as you are? Because those are not insignificant risks.
Right.
And people may end up losing a lot of money because of them.
Right. So we've been part of a version of this in the financial market itself. We have seen how much automation, algorithm trading, and getting more precise and reduce friction and reduce costs have done to the market. Bid-ask spread in the 90s was about half a cent for a typical stock. Today is 2% of a percent, right? You know, you go back 20 years, if you and I want to make a trade of 1,000 shares, you got to call a broker, pay them more than $100 in commissions, and pay about $30 in bid-ask spread. Today,
trading's free.
It may be commission-free, and your spread, you're going to pay is about $5. Mm-hmm. And by the way, you don't have to call anyone. You just do it on your phone. We've seen how much this has improved the market. I have no reason to believe why we can't do the same at so many other things we do as a society, which is to get together, make those decisions, and solve the problems. And we always have. We have always come together and solved these problems as they before it become too late.
Peng, here's where we'll wrap up.
Sure.
People in financial markets know who Citadel Securities is. Either they're a counterparty, or they recognize the function that you perform as a market maker in the options market and other markets. But for others, the name Citadel Securities didn't really land into the public conscience until January of 2022, when all of a sudden, you and Ken, and presumably others together, decided to sell $1.15 billion of interest, equity interest in the firm, to a couple of outside investors, Sequoia and Paradigm, valuing the business, I should add, at a stunning $22 billion. That was then. Here we are today, and you've helped us understand a little bit about where the firm is and what you're thinking. What's next?
So we started in making markets in equity and equity options in the US. Today, we are in more than 100 markets, more than 50 countries. We have 20 offices around the world in 12 countries. So in the short term, you can see the trend line from there to today. In the short term, more markets to make, more markets to solve by applying all the technologies and techniques and leveraging all that advancement, right? In the longer term, we truly believe we are a transformation agent, but applying all these cutting-edge thinking and AI, machine learning, and analytics to solving the entire capital market stack, right? So a lot of what we've talked about is in the area of trading on exchanges, or we call it low-touch trading, right? I'll give you an example to make this more concrete. Very recently, we've launched a product called investor valuation metrics, right? And what we do is we use the same analytics techniques to help corporates identify the asset managers and investors that should own their company, right? Same idea, but yet another way to help people who want to raise capital to find the investors who want to invest.
With that, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Peng Zhao.
Thank you, Erik.
Thank you.
Some days we might fall apart, and some nights might feel cold and dark.
Just a reminder that tonight, Late Night with Chris Tucker in the Wilshire Ballroom at 9 p.m.
And know it was worth